Alright, hello people, Shadowkey392 here, and welcome back to Kerbal Space Program. Now, in this video, we are not going to be continuing on with our career mode series. That will be in our next Kerbal Space Program video. In this video, we're in the sandbox, because I've got a few things I want to show you. Okay. So about a little under one week ago, I was on YouTube surfing around checking out Kerbal Space Program videos, as people who like Kerbal Space Program and are on YouTube tend to do. And I decided to check on one of my favorite channels, Undying Blaze. He's a more well-known YouTuber than I am, but that's really not saying that much, considering I'm pretty unknown. I think I only have about 8 subscribers, maybe more than that, if I'm probably wrong. But I don't have that many, and he's got more than me, but that's not a large number either. Anyways, he does videos of himself playing games, including Kerbal Space Program. And I thought, I wonder what he's been up to. I wonder if he's played it lately. So I went to check out his channel, and I found out he'd moved. He'd given himself a new channel with a new name, Nano Mango. So I followed him over there. Now, I checked out that. So yes, over there, I was on his channel. Well, not on his channel. I was looking at his channel, going through his videos, and I came across his most recent Kerbal Space Program video. And in it, he'd uploaded it about 5 months ago, I think. And somehow I'd missed it. I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. Somehow I'd missed his moving. He'd moved like way before that. I don't know how I missed it, but I did. But it's fixed now. I'm subscribed to Nano Mango now, and I'm watching his videos. Pretty, well, not closely, but not intently either, but, you know, I'm watching his videos. Leave it at that. I don't know what I was going to say next after saying I was watching his videos. But anyways, in his most recent Kerbal Space Program video, he showed off some of his more interesting rockets, plus a helicopter of sorts, which was really cool. It actually flew. Really, really cool. Didn't really fly anywhere except up, but yeah, it was a helicopter, and it worked, so cool. Anywho, as I was watching his video, I got to thinking about the fact that I've actually created some fairly interesting things of my own. And after the video was over, I commented on it and said, this is really interesting. Essentially what I said was, these are really cool. Or at least that's what I thought. I can't remember if that's what I said or not, but what I do know I said is, I've created some pretty interesting things on my own. And I'm thinking about showing them off. That's what I said, more or less, in my comment. And he commented back, he replied to my comment and said that he'd like to see that. That he'd like to see the stuff I've made. So I said to myself, and to him in a reply, all right, I'm going to do that. And ever since then, I've been busying myself trying to figure out what stuff to show off. And I've come up with a list of, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12... maybe 13, I'm not really sure about one of these, but definitely 12 of my more interesting creations. And that's what we're looking at today. So let's start off. We're on Minmus here, because I landed the first of these on Minmus 6 days ago. And I call it the Ion Rover. 13 parts. It's got 13 parts. It weighs a total of 1.429 tons. Height, 1.7 meters. Width, 1.8 meters. And length, also 1.8 meters. It costs... Well, I don't know what it costs. I seem to have forgotten to write that down. Or to type that. Oh well, it didn't cost very much to make. Not very expensive craft, just a small exploration sort of vehicle for exploring really, really low gravity worlds, like Minmus. For example, I mean, like, this thing would never get you off the ground on Kerbin. I don't think it would even work on the moon. But Minmus, definitely. Definitely it can get off the ground here. Dundrin Kerman is in the external command chair. He's taking us up now. Where are we going to go? Let's just hop right over to our vehicle, rocket over here. So, story behind this thing. Oh, hello. That's weird. There is on YouTube another YouTuber, obviously. I'm not the only one. Anyways, his name is Shadow Zone. His YouTube name, anyways, is Shadow Zone. And I'm subscribed to him. And if you're not subscribed to him and you like Kerbal Space Program, you really should subscribe to him because he has got some really interesting things on that channel. What the heck? I do not... Oh. Well, that's weird. Anyways, yeah, if you don't know what he is all about and you like Kerbal Space Program, you should go check him out. It's Shadow Zone. He's created some really interesting things, one of which was a small craft propelled by ion motors, like this one is, and he called it the Ion Bike. And I thought, well, basically, it's a hovercraft powered by an ion engine, and it worked really well, and I liked it. I thought, that's cool. I'm going to make my own. And that led to the creation of this thing, the Ion Rover. So, quick save there. It's powered, let's see. Propelled along by this Dawn electric propulsion system. One single xenon container. Three Z400 rechargeable battery packs. Two of these OX4W 3x2 photovoltaic panels, and of course, Dondrin Kerman in the EZ1, in the EA, I think it's easy, is what they mean to say, maybe. EAS1, kind of, maybe easy, I don't know. But he's in the external command seat, and this thing actually controls really well. It can actually take us quite a distance across Minmus, so long as you remember to leave enough of an electrical charge to... and enough distance between yourself and the ground to land this thing. But yes, that is the first thing. The first vehicle. Let us check that off here. Yes, I have a checklist here. Otherwise, I made myself a checklist because I didn't want to forget which ones I've done and get turned around, start going backwards or anything like that. No, if I didn't have a list, that's exactly what would happen. So, to the Space Center now for the second one. A second craft in this list, or on this list. Okay, so... Come on. Thank you. Where are we here? Aha. So I call this one the Shuttle Pod. This is it, right here, right at the top. Just this little thing. The Shuttle Pod. Who's gonna be our guinea pig? Kurdok Kerman, excellent man. We'd have Jebediah here, but he's unfortunately stranded on the moon along with Bob, Bill, Val, and all the core Kerbals have been stranded on the moon for some time now, and I have yet to go and get them. I really should do that. It's kind of unfair to them leaving them stranded on the moon while all these really cool things are being made back home. Anyways, Let's launch this thing off the ground. This is the shuttle pod with its booster. Let's speed up. Oh. Yes, I know that. I know physics doesn't exactly... I know time warp doesn't exactly get along too well with larger ships. Should be fine with this one, though. Now, this one is actually capable of sticking this thing into orbit, but in the interest of conserving time with this video, we're just going to go straight up, more or less. Maybe go over a little ways, just so we don't have a steep trajectory into the atmosphere on our way back down, and we'll just drop this thing right into the atmosphere. How high did this go? Oh well. Alright. Just get this lined up correctly here with the horizon. And we'll burn again. Yeah, this thing could easily park us into an orbit. I should warp up here. I don't want to have a steep re-entry angle, so... Yes. Okay. Okay. Da, 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 da. Let's see here. Perfect. That should do. Alright, let's dump this stage. And release the... Wait, what's this? Oh, yes. So here we are in the shuttle pod. This is a very... Well, this isn't much... this isn't actually much larger than the Ion Rover, actually. Let's see. It's got 15 parts total. 34 if you include the rocket that got us up here. Mass, 4.621 tons. 267.330 tons with the booster. Height, 6.2 meters, or 39.4 meters, again, with the booster. Width, 1.6 meters, that's 6.7 meters, with the booster. Length, 4.3 meters, and 6.6 meters with the booster. And a total cost to launch of $98,714.46 in funding. So yeah, not a very expensive thing. Now this will not really get us anywhere. It's not got enough fuel. Its only fuel source is this single FTL or FLT-400 fuel tank. And that's not very much. This vehicle is not designed to go anywhere other than low Kerbal orbit. Oh, what are we doing? Ah. We've pushed ourselves out a ways, I see. Okay. We'll warp here. And we'll push ourselves back down into the atmosphere. And then we'll give this thing a proper demo. Hopefully, we should have enough time to get through all of these things. I don't intend to spend too much time on all of them. Okay, here we go. Let's see. That's good. Probably. So yes, we'll just let ourselves drop into the atmosphere now. And then we shall fly this thing back home. We won't be going anywhere except into an ocean, but that's all right. This thing is designed to land pretty much anywhere except for on a mountain. Oh dear. We are overheating. Better burn retrograde. It's not gonna do anything. Initiate spinning! Don't get sick in there, Kurdok. That's very expensive equipment in there. Oh dear. Ah! Boom. Okay. Let's try that again. Not so high this time. And also not so steep a re-entry. In fact, you know what? Let's not bother going to space. Let's just fly it around. There's not much it can really do in space, aside from what we've just shown it to be able to do. But it's pretty decent at flying. All things considered, it's not the best at flying, but it can get you back to base. Come on, you stupid thing. Don't think we got it up to enough speed. Alright, let's see. Final attempt. It flies better at high altitudes. So... yeah. Yeah, it does work, though. I do have videos of it working. I think I'll have to link you into them. Because I'm not about to waste more time on this now. Anyways. I'll just make myself a note to do that. Alright, so next thing. Actually, why are we? We don't need to be in the VAB. We can just do this from the launch pad. Ah, let's see. Here we are. Excuse me. Where are we? Aha! Here we are. Submarine 2. Okay, so this is not a stock. This is, well, you'll see what this is in a minute or two here. Alright, so here we have this vehicle. Like it said in the description, if you saw that, this can actually get its payload into space, but we're not going to do that. We're going to stay right down here on Kerbal. This only needs to get us... Oh, it's a very short distance away. So anyways, about this vehicle. You might have noticed that Kerbin is covered in a whole lot of water. And you might have noticed that there is actually stuff under that water. And a number of people have thought, you know, would it not be great if we could go under the water? And that's which has led, of course, to a number of people trying to build submarines. Some people with stock parts. Other people, however, have tried to go the extra mile, in my opinion, and have made mods for submarines. And that is what I have done with this here. I haven't made a mod. I'm using one. I believe it's called... I think it's called Umbara. Excuse me. Oh, there's Minmus up there. Umbara or something. Umbra. Something like that. It's a submarine mod. It gives you stock parts for submarines. Or for a submarine. It's the, as far as I'm aware, it is not complete yet, but it's complete enough to work. So, we'll just let this thing drop down into the sea. I don't use hyper edit, so everything I do in this game has to involve rockets. I couldn't just hyper edit this thing into the ocean here. So, come down we come. Alrighty to then. Oh, water's got x-ray properties! It's showing us inside the bearing, and we just lost about half of our rocket there. Which is to be expected, that always happens. Alright, so. Let's lose this thing now. And there she is. There is our submarine from the mod. And already she is trying to sink. Alright, let's start her up here. Separate from that. Start the reactor. Yes, this thing actually has a reactor which you have to start in order to use. And now we can trigger... Hold on. Let's get this stuff off our top first. There we go. Oh. Piece of the fairing is still clinging to us rather tenaciously here. Off you go. We don't want you. You're useless to us now. Alright, so... Here we are, free of our fairings, and on our way down to the bottom of the sea. Kurdok Kerman in the Otter submersible pod at the front here. All these things here are ballast tanks. These two things are ballast tanks. These two ballast tanks here. Actually, this is, yeah, ballast tanks, more ballast tanks. These are full. All these ones here are full. These are both empty. Otherwise, this thing really does not get off the ground that well. These are lights. This is a science experiment which does nothing. Still cool though. Aquatic sample collector. Anyways, let's fire up our engines. If you listen, we have bubbles popping. That's from the mod. That's also from the mod. This was a really detailed mod. Okay, so we'll switch our lights on now so we can see what the heck we're doing down here. And this thing is a top speed of about 22.9 meters per second. It's made out of 49 parts, with a mass of 27.169 tons, Well, there's the bottom. There's the bottom. We're coming up on the bottom now. Shut ourselves down, or shut our motors down. Height 8.8 meters, width 3.5 meters, length 5.4 meters, and a cost to launch of $123,200.50 in funding. So, yes, this thing is meant for deep seas exploration, and in theory, it could land on a planet, on another planet. I've never tried that yet. I actually haven't tried to send anything to other planets. But it could be done. In theory. And yes, I gave this thing landing gear so we can land on the bottom of the sea. Still a little front heavy, I see. And you can still bounce on the bottom of the sea. Okay, so yes, we're down at the bottom of the sea. So, let's see. How to get up. All you have to do is take off like an aircraft to get off the bottom of the sea. Get started rolling. Pull the nose of this thing up. Pretty sure. Come on, up you come. There we go. And for a finale, let's just launch this thing out of the water at full steam. Kurdok doesn't look too sure about this. There he is inside. It's a very simple thing inside, not much in the way of detail. Oh. Yes, this has a giant, Clampotron docking port. Not giant, but it's a Clampotron docking port on the top, so in theory, you could build another sub. I could build another submarine, land this one at the bottom of the sea, and then dock the two. I haven't tried that yet, but it could happen. Anyways, here we are coming up on the surface. And we're free and clear and reaching like a dolphin. And now we're under the sea again, and sinking. So yes, that's the Submarine 2. There is a Submarine 1, but it's nowhere near as interesting. It's basically just the pod on the front, and that's it. Not at all worth showing. So yes, that's Submarine 2. Next up... next up is the TriStar Mark I. And it's a very simple little thing. Haven't flown it in a while, but... it should still work. Anyways, on YouTube there's another YouTuber, who plays games. His name is Markiplier. You've probably heard of him. He played Kerbal Space Program once upon a time. I don't know, think he's done anything with it recently. But in his video... oh, hey, that's weird. Random battery pack on the side. Huh. Anyways, in one of his videos, he attempted to make a three-engine spacecraft, rather like this one. and he attempted to get it off the ground. It flew, but not very well, so I thought, you know what, I'm going to try doing something similar. I'm going to make a craft just like that one, or similar anyways, and I'm going to make it fly properly. This resulted. This is the TriStar Mark I. There are actually three of these, with some minute differences. My Mark II just has is basically this thing, only with some RCS thrusters on it. And the Mark III is, again, basically this thing, only with RCS thrusters. And I swapped out these swivel engines for some Terriers. And it requires a rocket booster in order to get itself into space. But not this one, though. Not the Mark I or the Mark II. They are capable of getting into space entirely on their own. But not into orbit. They are suborbital craft. Oh dear. They are entirely suborbital craft. How far out did that go? Oh, it went pretty far. Hopefully this... it's not too far. So yes. Now the whole thing, the entire TriStar Mark I, 25 parts, a mass of 29.505 tons, height 7.9 meters, width 4.2 meters, length 4.9 meters, and a cost of $14,680 funding. So yeah, rather inexpensive craft. Good for a quick jaunt out beyond the Kerbin's atmosphere and right back home again. Alright, let's see here. Hopefully, we haven't made a mistake. I feel like we've made a mistake. Oh yeah, we've definitely made a mistake here. Later, do your thing. We're at 9,000 meters and plummeting fast. Oh wait, no. I think we're going to survive. We're going to be okay. Yeah, we're okay. Anyways, yeah, that's that. That is the TriStar Mark I. Cover that. Yes. Ready for next assignment. Okay, next on the list. Now, this one requires, a bit of explaining here. You see, at one point in Kerbal Space Program, you have to be careful with how you re-enter the atmosphere, because, or with how you enter atmospheres, because you can get up. Well, you build up re-entry heat. You saw what happened. You saw things overheating in the video just now, and you saw us blow up the shuttle pod, also from overheating. But, and it applies to Kerbals. You see, if you try to jump a Kerbal down from space, completely unprotected, now, in the game, they won't even make it to the point where they're getting re-entry heating effects. They'll just go poof, like, pretty much right off the bat. When the second they hit the atmosphere, they will go poof, and it will say they have died. And that's because of overheating. But it wasn't always that way. There was a time in Kerbal Space Program when you could drop a Kerbal from orbit, and they would survive. a fall from orbit through the atmosphere and hitting the ground. And they'd just get up and be ready to go again. But you can't do that anymore. Not without assistance. Which is what this thing is all about. This is Space Diver One, and it was designed to bring about the newest extreme sport. The newest Kerbal extreme sport, anyways. Space diving. So, yes, this is a very simple launch vehicle. It's just a single LFB KR-1x2 twin-bore liquid-fuel engine stage with some fins on it for stabilization. Whoa, whoa, whoa. We don't want to go... Excellent. Okay. So, stats for this thing. Parts, 29. Mass of 45.957 tons. A height of 13.6 meters. A width of 5.5 meters. And a length of 5.5 meters. And a cost of $29,483... whatever the units they use for funding. And I just say funding. $29,483.35 in funding. So yes, this thing is meant to recapture, or to, to get as close as possible to space diving, which, as I said, was dropping your, I described it, it's dropping your Kerbal from orbit to the ground. You can't really do that in the game anymore without help, and that's what this thing is all about. So yes, we are about to drop Mr. Kurdok Kerman here not from orbit, but from space, through Kerman's atmosphere to the ground, and he is going to survive completely unprotected, more or less. So we'll ditch that rocket stage, it can do nothing more for us, lose the fairing. Well, shoot, that wasn't supposed to happen. We deployed the space diver without Kurdok. Okay, here we go. So we'll just zip ourselves right out past the atmosphere again. Good. Quick save this time, just to be safe. Lose the stage. Lose that. And now, out pops Kurdok from the lander can, the Mark 1 lander can, and he will just EVA on over to this thing. This is the space diver itself. And as you can see, it is very simplistic. It has nothing, but a Probodyne Octo 2, which we will control this from, because controlling this thing from the command chair screws everything up, a heat shield, and this rocket motor here, which is designed This could actually put itself into an orbit, I think. But really, I just kind of want to demo it. There's no rhythm. Well, actually, it's meant to drop this thing out of an orbit. And into the atmosphere. But we don't need to do that. So now we ditch this, leaving just a heat shield, a couple of batteries, the Octo 2, these drogue chutes, which are all this thing needs to slow itself down, and Kurdok in the command chair, more or less completely unprotected, save for his spacesuit. And yes, he is going to fall through Kerbin's atmosphere, all 70,000 meters of it. And he is going to arrive completely unharmed on Kerbin's surface. We hope. Good luck to you, Kurdok, sir. Shouldn't have ditched the rocket motor so soon. That might be a problem. We should have waited. We should have let it set us retrograde first. That doesn't look like it'll be too much of a problem. It's just getting the fronts and backs of his head lightly tanned. That's all. He's hard to see through the fire here, but he appears to be enjoying himself. What extreme sport daredevil person wouldn't? And just like that, he is through the worst of it. And, well on his way to touching down. Time warp here. Drogue chutes now. So yes, ladies and gentlemen, Kurdok Kerman has just survived a 70,000 meter plunge through Kerbin's atmosphere, completely unprotected, save for the heat shield. Space diving is back. All right, so now, next up, let's see, where are we here? The Vector Airspace Fighter. So I wanted to create something cool. I wanted to create a sort of a futuristic-y sort of space starfighter thing. And that led to this thing being created. The Vector Airspace Fighter. 266 parts, 346 counting this booster rocket here. This, unlike the TriStar Mark I, which it's kind of based on, I guess, It can't get into orbit on its own. Excuse me. None of the airspace fighters I've developed can. They all require a powerful booster rocket to get themselves up into space. This is the heaviest one that I've built, so this requires the most powerful booster. anyways, so yes, with the booster, it's got a combined mass of 673.318 tons. Without the booster, just 100 tons. It's a height of 16.8 meters, 59.5 meters with the booster. Width of 9.0 meters, length 10.0 meters, and a total cost for launching of $250,924 in funding. And now we've got to wait for the solid rocket boosters to burn themselves out before we do anything more with this thing. I'm not going to send this thing into space. Oh dear. But we don't have to wait for them anymore. That wasn't supposed to happen. Let's try that again. That's the danger of time warping, my friends. It plays havoc with your craft. Okay, let's try this again. Just a little bit of time warping this time. Yes, this thing actually can breach the atmosphere. It can get out into space, stick itself into an orbit. We're not going to do that. We're probably just going to stick this thing into a suborbital flight. So, let's see. We got that stage. Fire this one! Should put us into space. Then so. Well, we'll just let it go. Stage early. Oh well. We'll decouple that. So yes, this thing has a decoupler here, docking port here. It's meant to be docked within space and refueled. It's powered by these three vector engines, hence the name the Vector Airspace Fighter. The other two airspace fighters I've built are the Terrier and Thud airspace fighters. Not very imaginative, I know, so sue me. But, yeah. They work. They can't really go very far. But they do fly. They can re-enter the atmosphere, though they don't fly too well. So, we're going to do that now. We're going to re-enter the atmosphere and try to land this thing. I've done it once before. Earlier today, before recording this video, I successfully landed this thing in the water. Though it was a rather close call. If I do say so myself. So let's see if we can't repeat that. Good Lord, I love the re-entry effects in this game. Somehow I don't think they're the best that they could be, but they're pretty good. Okay, so on our way down, we have to periodically fire the engines, otherwise this thing is liable to try to flip itself. Which we can see it's trying to do here. No, 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 you're not flipping yourself, not today. We also have to fire our engines in order to slow ourselves down to prevent our wings from burning off. Our great big, gawky wings. The big S Delta wings. Hey! No, you're not flipping today, not on me. Colorful exhaust. And now we're in a spin. That also happened the last time I tried to do this. Can't really be helped. My guess is it's because of the wings. Or it could be something else. Excuse me. Could just be that this thing is not a very good aircraft. It's more for space than for air, really. Even though it is called an airspace fighter. So we'll deploy our non-airships. And it has landed and remained intact. And we have fuel left, so technically, this doesn't want to stay. I was wondering if we could sort of drive it around like a boat, but I guess not. No. What did we just lose? Well, hey, we're flying now. That's something. What did we just lose? Oh, some fuel tanks. Yeah, we're flying though. That's interesting. Oh, we lost some on that wing there. Aha. And yeah, it can fly in atmosphere to a degree. Not very well, though. So yes, that's the Vector Airspace Fighter. Now, for page 2 of my list, we're halfway through it. Moving on... Moving on from the Vector Airspace Fighter, we have the Tri-Wing Drone, which is exactly what it sounds like, a drone with three wings. Each wing is connected to a great big hulking mammoth engine. This was inspired by another thing which Shadow Zone did. He created, I think it was a subscriber special. He had reached a certain number of subscribers and wanted to celebrate, so he created this great big spacecraft with three wings and three engines, and it was awesome. And I tried to download it, and for whatever reason, it didn't work. I downloaded it, but the only things that showed up were... Only a chunk of it showed up, so obviously I couldn't fly it. Like, only the bottom half of it, I think? Somehow that got decapitated. I don't know. But I decided to try building my own thing, and this resulted. Yeah, that happens. Kind of weird. Look, flying saucer, Frisbee. So yeah, it doesn't really work too well. Still fun to watch, though. Let's try a half power. Still gonna do that. Lower power still. Auto-strutting this thing. It kind of helped. So yeah, this thing... Interesting. Where are you two going? They're flying independently. I'm sure they'll come down on some poor soul's unlucky house somewhere. Anyways, what happened there? Ah. The tanks mounted on the wings collided into their own wings. Interesting. Anyways, yeah, I wasn't expecting anything too different with that. It's not a very workable design. But this next one is... So this next one... is a much more practical design. Actually designed to do things, to be actually useful, and not just things of interest like those last few ones have been. In fact, of all the previous craft that we've looked at in this video, only the Ion Rover was designed with an actual purpose, or with an actual purpose in mind. The rest were just designed for the fun. The Ion rover was also designed for fun, but it was also designed with the intention for the... it was designed with the intention of using it to explore Minmus. So where are we now? What are we looking at? Oh, lander launcher. The lander launcher tester 2, where are you? Aha. Uh-huh. Okay, so this here is the lander launcher. It's a craft designed... well, it's basically a lander, which is designed to launch from the surface of a planet and achieve orbit around Kerbin, or... I think, well, this can do sub-orbit. This one can do orbit because of the MechJeb 2 pod on top. It has its own rocket fuel. It can get into orbit on its own. This is the landing stage here. This is the middle stage. And, there's the MechJeb pod on top. Anyways, it can actually leave Kerbin. So, I built that. I built that for the intention of being able to land on a planet and then return from it. I then built this thing, the Lander Launcher Tester, with the intention, or with the idea that this would carry this thing into space, and then I'd drop it. It has to see if it could actually do it. And it could. Barely. I'm going to show you guys the Lander Launcher Tester 2, though, because this is a manned one. This is designed to do it with Kerbals. So, Lander Launcher Tester 2. 110 parts. Mass 427.635 tons. Height 33.3 meters. I don't need the RCS on yet. Width 11.5 meters. Oh, hi. What the heck? Staging is weird. Width 11.5 meters, length 11.5 meters, and a cost to launch of $157,150.4 in funding. What the heck are you doing down there? You're not supposed to be down there. Jettison heat shield. Heck no, we need you, heat shield. All right, let's do this. I don't think we'll go to space with this one, either. It'll take a while to get up there and do its stuff, so we'll just leave it there. So, anyways... yes, this is the lander. The actual lander portion. There's the crew module. It's got its own heat shield, because this thing has a tendency to flip over, I've found. And I don't like that. So we'll jettison the heat shield there. Deploy our parachutes. Jettison that heat shield because we don't need it. And we will fall. And it appears we're going to land on the mountainside. How nice. Extend our landing gear. Okay, so we are down. Now that we are down, time to leave again. The Cepatrons get us away, and then this main, skipper liquid fuel engine will take us up into space and into orbit. Well, actually, I don't know if this thing can do orbit, but it definitely can do space. Which is enough, because this is Kerbin. We don't want to go anywhere other than home. And we're flipping now. Lovely. So, yeah, that's the lander launcher. Activated our parachutes a little too soon there. Fortunately, we were able to disarm them. So yeah, this thing can get us out a fair ways into space. With a little more fuel, it might be capable of sticking us into orbit, but as it is, it can't. Not with it could do it with a mech jet pod, but again, that's because the mech jet pod has its own little monopropellant fuel source and engines, so it's capable of propelling itself into orbit. This command pod has no such stuff like that, so it can't. All it can do is suborbital flight. So yeah, that's that. We're not going to bother letting this thing land, because we all know it's going to land safely and soundly. Which is what it's designed to do. Okay, now for this next one, I'm not going to launch it because I've already done that in a video. I've already made a video of this thing launching. I will link it. I'll link I've made three videos about this next thing. I'll link them to this video here. One moment, just making myself another note. If you've seen those videos, you should recognize this thing. This next craft. Warship One. Okay, so this is another craft that's capable, that is possible because of a mod, the BD Armories mod, which provides all sorts of awesome weapons. I mean, this is it. This is it right here on the left here. These are all the stuff the mod gives us. It gives us various kinds of ammunition, a 50 cal turret, adjustable missile rails, bomb racks, various missiles. We got a Hellfire, a Maverick, cruise missile, HARM. We got an AI pilot flight computer so you can have your own dogfights with AI drones. More missiles, radomes, radar, tow missiles, chaff dispensers, cluster bombs, ammunition boxes for cannons, flares, targeting balls, more guns, various kinds of guns. They're all very awesome, by the way. Even more missiles, more radar, explosive warheads, lasers. It's awesome. Very awesome mod. Highly recommend it if you like blowing things up. So anyways, yes, I built this from it. This is Warship One. Again, I'm not gonna launch this. I've already made a videos of that. So I'll link them to you here. But the specifics of this thing. This is where we're, by the way, this is where we're starting to get into my really big part things. Really big craft. So, the Warship One is composed of 243 parts with a total mass of 747.858 tons, height 58.4 meters, width 6.5, length 9.3 meters, and a cost of $330,408 in funding. It's designed to be a warship. I was on YouTube before I designed this, and I remember thinking, I want to build my own warship. I mean, like, I want a Star Destroyer, because, well, they're cool. But I decided, yeah, I'm probably not going to be able to do a Star Destroyer right from the get-go. I'm just going to start simple. Let's just launch a simple rocket with some guns on it. And that led to Warship One. So, the guns. So yes, this is Warship One. Not much of a warship, really. It's a single-person craft. Single-person craft. I've actually got one in orbit. Of course, I don't think I can fire the guns because it doesn't have a weapon manager now. The one in orbit does not have a weapon manager. Let's just give this one one. Actually, let's... No cupola, no crew. Weird. Let's fix that, shall we? Weird. What's his name has vanished. Well, we don't really need anybody. We don't need any pilots for this. We'll just plop a scientist in here. We're not gonna launch this thing. We're just gonna use these M1 Abrams tank turrets that we've got it with. So yes, this is Warship One. It's outfitted with a total of 6 M1 Abrams tank turret cannons, courtesy of the BD weapons mod. And they can all be aimed and fired. Now the trigger is armed. Let's destroy the runway. Yeah, this is sweet. Actually, you know what? Let's launch this thing. Just momentarily. Fire on the VAB! It's fun! So yeah, that's the guns on this thing. This is awesome. That mod is awesome. BDA weapons is awesome. I think we're out of range. So, yeah, that's that. That's Warship One, and again, I will link those videos either in the video or in the description so that you can check them out and see the awesomeness and the hilarity. Because there was some hilarity. So, moving on. Okay, now Warship One was not actually my first attempt to make a warship. There was one other. This is the Mammoth. And it is the third largest space vehicle I have. It has no weapons, but it was designed originally to be a space-going war machine. So, yes, the Mammoth. 189 parts, mass of 2,253.955 tons, height 45.7 meters, width 15.7 meters, length 11.5 meters, and a cost to launch of $811,226 or in funding. So yes, we are getting into the really big, really expensive rockets now. This one, I believe, has mech jeb on it. Does it? No? Oh, yes, it does. Good. Let's fly this thing. Okay. So yeah. This is it. This be the Mammoth in flight. And yes, it has solid rocket boosters on its second stage, and not on its first. So this thing really has no purpose aside from looking, well, from being big, and to see if, well, to see if a ship this large could even make it off the ground. That was the whole point behind my building this thing. I wanted to see if I could build a large craft like this, which could potentially be outfitted with guns. And see, I wanted to see if it could even make it into space, just without the guns. And it can! It can totally make it into space. As we shall see shortly. So we've expended the first two stages there. And discard them now. That one, because it's the only one holding these six other still functioning engines on. And explosions! Just now this thing is being propelled entirely by solid rocket boosters. Also, these two Rhino liquid fuel engines on the sides. Right. Expediency, let's just time warp this a bit. Hello, drop those boosters and fire our other engines, and now we are reaching the atmosphere. Not exactly maneuverable on RCS alone, but it can maneuver. It can also get itself into an orbit, but that would have required we angle our ascent trajectory somewhat, which we did not, so it can't. But yeah, it can make it into orbit. Lights, and I don't think I put the solar panels on a hotkey, did I? Maybe I didn't. I have to fix that. So yes, we have some solar panels on each side of this thing. We have the docking port on this, on the top of this thing too, for refueling and personnel replacement. I don't know how far this thing craft could actually take us. I'll have to try that sometime. I'll have to see if I can get this, how far this thing can go. But that is for another video. That is for another video. So we will recover the vessel. Now, we are down to our last two craft. So this next one was actually built with a purpose in mind. It's one of the few that we've gone over that was built, that has been built with a, well, no, they've all been built with purposes in mind. This was the only one built with a serious, well, this is one of the few built with a serious, serious purpose in mind. Let's see, where is it here? Where are you? Oh, you're at the top, right here. Ah, yes, the fuel barge. Not a very imaginative name, but descriptive. It suits its purpose. This is a fuel barge. So, if you watch the videos I linked to, the Warship One videos that I link, you will notice that during the first video, Warship One expends all of its fuel to get into orbit. It has to. Which means that once it's up there, if we want to send Warship One places, we have to get fuel up to it. Right. That is the purpose of this, the fuel barge, the second most massive craft I have ever built in this game. All of this, the fuel barge has 452 parts, a height of 62.6 meters, a width of 18.9 meters, a length of 18.9 meters, and a mass of 2,872.629 tons. That's right. So yeah, about 2,873 tons of rocket, all to get just this single tank of fuel into space. I'm not going to launch this in this video because this thing is so freaking heavy that it takes a long time to get into or get into space even. It takes a little bit to get off the pad even. Like just to get off the ground. So yeah, I'm not gonna launch it in this video. But you can see it launch in the Warship One videos. It's really kind of a spectacle. Oh, and its launching cost is $1,269,248 in funds. So, yeah. Pretty expensive. And now, for the last vehicle. The last one I'm going to show off. In hindsight, I'm just thinking I really should have explained how the fuel barge actually flies. I did that in the Warship One videos. So if you're interested in that, you can just check those out. They'll tell you. Or the second one will tell you. That is, no, third one. The third one will tell you. The third one will show you how it flies and how it works. Anyways, we are now at our last vehicle. Okay, so this is the K-Star Stingray. This is not the vehicle I'm going to show you. But I have to show this to you because it's, well, it's a part of the vehicle I'm going to show you. So this is not my creation. As the description says here, it's one of Shadowzone's creations. He created this. This is one of his awesome creations, and it's really cool. Although for some reason it's got a fuel imbalance, which I don't know how to correct. For some reason the starboard engine pod gets more fuel than the port side engine pod. But anyways, he built this to be a vertical, it's a vertical takeoff thing. It can, it's, he used, well, it's not meant to launch from a planet. At least I don't think so. He does not appear to have designed it to launch from a planet. But it works, it works. Basically, it's a it's an exploration vehicle. He in the video in which he demoed it, he sent it to the moon first, and then to Duna. And yeah, it was really cool. So I downloaded it because he put a link, he does that. He lets you download his creations. And then I thought, I want to fly this thing, but how am I going to get it into space? Because, you see, he used HyperEdit to get this thing into space. But me, I don't do that. I don't like HyperEdit. I have never used it. I kind of think of it as cheating, and cheating is not something I do. So everything I do in this game has to be done with conventional, through conventional means. Which means I had to build a rocket to get this thing into space. Into, well, not into orbit, but into space. The result, well, hold on a second here while this loads. Come on, you can load. You can do it. I believe in you. Here we are. Okay, so the result of my attempts to get this thing into space was this Colossus. This Titanic thing. It's got the very unimaginative name of K-Star Stingray with launch vehicle. The K-Star Stingray is what Shadowzone called this vehicle in the center here. The Stingray. And we are going to launch this. This is the, this is the largest craft I've got to date. It has 639 parts. Oh, it weighs 3,958.174 tons. It has a towering height of 52.6 meters, although, well, yeah, the fuel barge is actually larger than it by about 10 meters. Width, 15.5 meters, a length of 21.1 meters, and a total cost to launch of $1,463,950 in funding. So if you ever want to bankrupt your space program, just build this thing and launch it a few of it. You'll have yourself run out of money within no time. Let's fly this thing. Now, as with the fuel barge, this thing does take a while to get off the ground. I mean, I know it looks like it's not going anywhere, but look at the speed here. Look at the speed. We are slowly increasing. Slowly gaining velocity. And slowly ascending above the pad. This is why I did not fly the fuel barge in this video, because it behaves just like this. And this is going to take a long time to get into space. Yeah, you can see now it is flying. We're actually moving sideways off the pad. It moved off the pad and onto the crawler wing. Yeah, here we go. Now we're really gaining some altitude here. And look at this. Our solid rocket boosters are off the ground, and we are almost out of fuel, and we are only at 11.5 meters per second for speed. That is how big and heavy this thing is. Probably edit most of this out, actually, just for expediency's sake and to keep the video from being 2 hours long. I will likely edit most of this launch out. Excuse me. Okay, so we have discarded our solid rocket boosters now, and we are about to discard these two twin bore engines on either side. They have just about completed serving their purpose. Only at 4,000 meters. Okay, so now we are in space. We've just about expended all our fuel and our rockets. We are just kind of aligning ourselves parallel to the Kerbal's surface here. And now, discard these things. Start turning on our lights so we can see what we're doing, and so Hads in here can see what he's doing inside the cockpit. And discard fuel tanks. That is very weird. Very weird staging. Yeah, I'm pretty sure this was meant to designed to use asparagus staging. Or not asparagus staging, but... These are designed to run out of fuel first somehow or something. I'm not really sure. It's like I said. Well, no. Not like I said. It's been a very long time since I designed this thing. Anyways, here we are, free in space. Let's move. As far as the nuclear engines. Yeah, this thing does not move very fast. Looks something out of Star Wars, like something out of a Star Wars movie, though, doesn't it? I could see a ship designed like this being in a Star Wars movie. Or perhaps Star Trek. So yes, it's got those. It's also got these engines on its underbelly. For landing. But I use them to get myself into orbit. So, yeah, that's the K-Star Stingray. And again, that's not my creation, that's Shadow Zone's. I was just showing off the rocket I designed to build it, or to get it into space. So, that ends this video. I've shown you all the most interesting craft I've got. If I ever design any more, I'll be sure to show you those ones too. If you've been liking this video, well, no, before I go off, yeah, in our next video, we will be resuming Kerbal Space Program's career mode. So we'll see you then. If you've been watching this video, please like, share, add to your favorites, and subscribe, and I will see you guys in the next video. Shadowkey392, signing off.